God, as we gather in your house today, we ask you to hold in your embrace people that have been killed and hurt in Charolettesville. We ask that you touch the hearts of people so filled with hate in our midst. And we ask that you make us all mindful of the needs of others. Amen. Please be seated. So we have just heard the gospel reading, and we know that today's scripture is the story, indeed the miracle, of Jesus walking on water. Most of us, if not all of us, have heard this before. And maybe it's because I've heard it so many times that it has lost a little of its luster. I find that I am no longer impressed by this story. Maybe it's because I believe that Jesus is who he says he is. So in my mind, he ought to be able to do this and a great deal more. Now, I'm actually impressed with Peter walking on water. I'm impressed because Peter is like us. He's human. When Jesus says to Peter, not as a command, but as an invitation, come, he does. Now, I know what the haters will say, but Peter didn't actually walk on water. He sank. But that's not what the scripture says. Scripture says Peter began to sink, but it never says he went under completely. And even though he was sinking, he still took the time and had the presence of mind to say, Lord, save me. In that moment, Peter must have believed that Jesus could and would save him. And so we have arrived at the point when I must tell you that this is nearly all that is left of my original sermon. Today is a sad day in America. The events of the last 2 days in Charolettesville must be spoken about. Some things are hard to hear, and some things are harder yet to say. As we sit here today, I am mindful that many of those torch-carrying, hate-spewing white nationalists are sitting in the pews of churches this morning, just as we are. Now, I'm just going to let that sit with you for a moment. We have a national legislature that seems unsympathetic to the disenfranchised and anybody that isn't them. The leader of our country appears to be morally bankrupt, quick to anger, and ethically impotent. Those who say, I love God and hate their brothers or sisters or liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. From the first book of John, chapter 4, verse 20. And these are observations from a local pastor, Reverend Tracy Blackman, who has preached here on occasion, who was on the ground in Charolettesville, and I quote, whiteness is their God, privilege is their icon, rage is their prayer life, supremacy is their heaven. Lord, have mercy. I stand before you today with a broken heart. My grandmother once told me that if I lived long enough, I would see coal styles come back around again. Perhaps I have lived too long. Why? Because I never thought I would live to see the day where white folks would be marching in the streets with blazing torches again. But I have. The only difference is they're not wearing hoods this time. It seems they don't have to. Yes, I've lived too long. I've lived long enough to ride at the back of the bus. I've lived long enough to go round to the back door. I've lived long enough to be in crowds that had fire hoses and dogs turned on them. I've lived long enough to cross the street or step off the curb if a white person approached. I've lived long enough to drink from one of those colored-only fountains. I know what it's like not to be able to sit down at the counter of the local five and dime to have a soda or a sandwich. I've lived long enough to hear a white woman refuse to call my grandmother Mrs. Elmore because she said that that would put them on equal footing and she wasn't going to call no colored woman Mrs. I've lived long enough to have dared not travel around this country without the green book. If you don't know what that is, ask me about it after church. I have lived long enough to be called names that my mother did not give me. I have been living long enough to have been spat upon because of the color of my skin, which isn't much different than most of you here, but just enough, I guess. Many of us are in pain today. In pain because old wounds have been reopened and a finger has been stuck in. Forgotten images have been brought to life again by people full of anger and hate. People have died. People have been injured. Yet, some of us say we are surprised, not wanting to believe that our country is still capable of the despicable acts taking place in Charolettesville. Still others say that hate has been resurrected, but we can see that it never died for some people. The images are hard to see, hard to digest, and even harder to believe. Now, I have to ask myself, what are these self-proclaimed white nationalists so afraid of? Are they afraid of giving up their comfortable place in the boat? Are they afraid of losing their seats of privilege? Are they afraid of having to wade in the water if too many of us get into that boat? And I say to everyone here, what are we so afraid of? That our faith won't be strong enough? That we won't be able to walk on those troubled waters, that we'll lose sight of Jesus or he will lose sight of us, or that he won't be able to grab hold of us and pull us up. Well, I've got news for all of us. If we want to walk on the water like Peter, we've got to get out of the boat like Peter. If you want to experience the power of God in your life, you've got to step out on faith. This involves risky obedience, believing in God is a risky business. Having faith in God and serving Him is even riskier. Getting out of that boat is dangerous. Fear may keep us from getting out of that boat, but believing that that hand will first of all be there to pull you up, and that it can and will pull you up, is scary as hell. Can I get an amen from somebody? I know I'm not the only one. This has always been the plight of black folks in this country. But we cannot be so afraid of the storm that we lose sight of God in the midst of the storm. God has promised to be always with us. And I believe in God's promises. Dante said that the hottest places in hell are reserved for those who in times of great moral crisis maintain their neutrality. My brothers and sisters, the waters of discontent are teeming with hatred, racism, homophobia, and misogyny. And it doesn't stop there, the list goes on. We, the faithful, cannot sit idly by. We cannot allow entire groups of people to be consigned to the garbage heap because they've been deemed irrelevant by those in power. No life that God created is irrelevant. I have no doubt that God delighted in each and every being that He breathed life into. Despite what we may think, we are not God's quality control department. I know too that some of you are saying to yourselves, well, I would never do what those people are doing in Charolettesville, and I've never burned a cross or hung anybody from a tree, or horsewhipped anyone. Maybe not. But there are other ways in which we are all complicit. Black folks, we are complicit if we think all white people are the devil, that they're all there and they're out together. It's just not true. And white folks, do you grab your purse when someone black walks by? Do you say, well, he must have been doing something wrong or the police wouldn't have shot and killed him? Do you perpetuate stereotypes about groups of people without knowing the facts? I think we've all been guilty of this. And are there those of you who think that this country is actually yours to take back? The same country, by the way, that was taken from the Native Americans. Sometimes it's the smaller, more subtle things that drive us further apart. Intolerance, unkind words and behavior, making people feel unwelcome without actually saying it, and worse, making people feel that they don't matter. Some of us are drowning here today, but we refuse to go under, and we are reaching out for the hand of God to save us. I can't walk on water, and you can't walk on water, but there's another way into that boat. Choose to love. Following Jesus' example, we can extend a hand and pull one another up. We can love each other right into that boat with Jesus. I believe that love is the most powerful force in the world because it is born of God. Man didn't dream it up. Science didn't create it in a lab, and Hallmark didn't write it into a card. God himself ordained love to be the single greatest redeeming force in creation. We would do well to remember that we are called to be a loving presence in the world. We can witness our faith and demonstrate our love for each other by getting out of the boat and walking the troubled waters, all the while clinging to the words of Jesus, "Do not be afraid." Oh Lord, I get so tired sometimes, but I long for the day when people of faith will rise up together out of the waters of bigotry, racism, hatred, and division. I long for the day that we can all wade in the waters of mutual respect, unity, and love. The day when we can all reach out to grab Jesus' hand so we can be pulled up from wherever we are, sinking but not drowning. On that day, and only on that day, we, the people of faith, will be able to look up and say, "Jesus, Jesus, we're going to need a bigger boat." Amen. Amen.